Good evening, everyone. Once again, most welcome here for the webinar, which is conducted powered by Century Financial. My name is Yogesh. Many of you who are coming for the first time, welcome to everyone. Those who are attending this session, who have attended my previous sessions as well, welcome once again. We all know we have done these webinars on different topics. We have in the past we did topics like trading in crude oil, OPEC meetings. We did topics about maneuvering markets and maneuvering in volatile markets, which are the good stocks to pick during the pandemic. We have done different series of webinars while I was at home. And today I'm sitting here in office. No more virtual backgrounds. Offices have started. Life is getting back on track. But as we all know, that we still have to take a lot of precautions. I am right now in an enclosed cabin alone, so I'm not wearing any mask. But as soon as I go outside, or if I'm meeting somebody, I'm wearing gloves, mask, and everything. So all of you, please take care of yourself. A big vote of thanks to everyone who is involved into healthcare industry, doctors, nurses, first responders, midwives, everyone. If any of your friends, family, relatives, anybody who is into the healthcare industry, thank you so much. From my Century Financial, my team, myself, my family. Now, before we start this topic here, outlook for gold, what we'll be discussing today in this topic is first, what has happened in the past. We'll look into the historic price chart for gold. We'll also visit what happened back in 2008 when the market started coming down, and what happened to the gold prices, and then why gold prices all of a sudden went up during 2011, and what was the reason that it came down, and now why it has started going up. So there's a proper historical analysis of the gold prices. We'll also go through some of the factors. So many times when people are predicting gold prices, they definitely take into account what is happening with the interest rates. So interest rates are something which is really important. If interest rates are kept low, we might see always a decline. If interest rates are kept low, we might see decline in dollar, we might see a push in the gold prices. Similarly, if interest rates are higher, we see a stronger dollar, and we see a low gold price. So this has happened in the past, but there are a lot more other factors. I still see some of you are not able to hear me. Please give me okay on the chat if you are able to hear me. So I just want to ensure that my voice is reaching through. I see a lot of attendees here, so if you can hear me, please send me a okay. Okay, perfect. Thank you once again. For those who are not able to connect, don't worry about it. We'll put a copy of this webinar on the YouTube. So we are recording this session and we'll put it on YouTube as well. Now, the very purpose, as I said, today is to analyze the factors which can affect gold prices in the short run, in the long run. What is the importance of the central bank meetings, how interest rates are also able to decide where the gold prices will be, understanding the historic price analysis of gold, and then again going further and seeing what is the future expectation, what is the current. So right now the current scenario is very simple, very high uncertainty in the light of COVID-19 pandemic. Yes, pretty much momentum. If we see gold for gold prices, it has been going higher. Remarkable performance in the first half of 2020. The gold prices have gone up almost by 16.8% in dollar terms. It has significantly outperformed all the other major asset classes. Now, this is really important to understand. Most of the asset classes, if you compare, you will see that in the very first half of 2020, gold prices have performed. It has gone up by 16.5%. By the end of the June, prices were trading around $1,770. So what I'll do is I'll make it a much more interactive session. But obviously, you cannot talk through the session. But what you can do is I have kept the chat window open. So if you have any questions about the financial markets or other trading instruments or even for gold, preferably for gold. But then again, as I said, it's a very open session. I want to make it more interactive. So now, please keep sending your questions on the chat. I'll be available here. I will be talking about a lot of things. I'll try to answer your questions as well. Anything which you ask, if I'm not able to answer, that question will run through by my market consultants. And someone will be in touch with you over the call and definitely answer your question. So please keep writing. I would like to see this chat window ticking with questions. Any questions you have about the financial markets, please go ahead and ask. I'll try to answer as much as I can. So starting with what we were talking about, the gold prices, by the end of June, we saw that gold prices were around $1,770 per ounce. And this was a level which has not been seen since last 2012. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to show you a historic price movement of gold. Just sharing you a screen and I will increase this, the historic price chart. Please tell me if everybody is able to see the screen which I have shared in a proper resolution, those who are online by laptop or by phone. If you want me to zoom this, if you want me to just keep the screen as it is, accordingly, if everybody can see the chart, just give me okay. Yeah, okay, done. Everybody's able to see this chart. Now, when we are talking about gold in perspective, this is a historic price movement. Now, the technical analysis is a different subject altogether. I'm not going to show you about studies. I'm not going to show you about technical charts and everything. We are just going to visit the historical price movement. And in this, what you see right now is for last 10 months. So the graph which you see for the chart on the Trade Room or the Next Generation platform, which I'm showing you, this is for last 10 months. You can very easily move your cursor and select, let's say, 1 year. Now you're looking at last 12 months of gold price movement. But as I was saying, gold is revisiting the levels which it was last time in 2012. How do I see it? Let me go back to 2012. I will select, let's say, maximum, which I can go further. Now, if you see this chart, one very important thing, I'm looking at 2011 and 2012. If you see on the topmost, it's a very small font. I'm not sure whether you can see this, but here where my mouse is moving, this is 2011. 2012, this is where 2012, let me find the cursor, yes. This is 2012, then 2013, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, and this is current 2020. So by the end of June, here, June 2020, we saw gold prices reaching 1770. Now this was the level, as you can see on your left, this is June 2020, right here. And if you see this 2013 and 2012, so the levels which gold is trading right now were 8 years ago. This is a good news for all those who had bought gold in 2011 and they could never see that particular price in the next 8 or 9 years. Now, again, in 2020, they have started seeing gold, which the price which it was in 2011 and 12. That brings us to one point. First point is the very important one, that when we are talking about investments or trading commodities, a lot depends upon the risk. A lot depends upon the global scenario. A lot depends upon the geopolitical factors, whether we are talking about oil or gold. A lot depend upon the macro factors also, the demand and supply, everything. So please understand this. When you invest into a commodity, you are exposing yourself to a certain amount of risk. And risk is there in every investment. But you have to really understand this and then invest. Because the example which I gave you, just imagine if somebody invested in gold back in 2011 or 2012, when it was $1,790 per ounce. Over the next period of 8 years till 2020, nobody saw this price back. So basically, you locked in your money for 8 years by purchasing gold at those levels, right? So that's why when you are investing in commodities market, please understand that the prices of commodities can be really volatile, okay? Do not jump on conclusions. Please calculate your risk. Do not borrow money. Do not take a loan to invest into financial markets. It can be really risky. You have to stress on your risk management. You have to focus on risk minimization. And there is a probability that if you're focusing more on risk minimization, you might get a positive result also. So that should be the very focus of your investment, proper risk management and diversification. Exposing yourself to only one asset class is a failure of diversifying your portfolio. If you plan to diversify your portfolio, you do not have to focus on one asset class. You have to divide your money into separate asset classes. Something, if we get time, then we'll go through the platform and see that how can we diversify. So moving on, as I said, that there are a lot of factors on what gold prices depends. So what are these factors that affect the gold prices? Since we'll be talking about the forecast, the price trends, first we should understand what are the factors. And when I show you here, there are few factors which we can see, which definitely most of the time it affect the gold prices. The US dollar, the investment demand, central bank buying, obviously central bank play a really important role, trading volumes on the exchange, new mining supply. So demand and supply are two very important factors. Although, I'm not getting involved into the macro factors, that is a given. It has been acting as a safe haven for a lot of investors. So that is given, but these are some factors which investors might not even look at it given what the situation is, but you have to have a look on these factors also, the economic and the monetary factors as well, right? So we'll go one by one to understand that what are these factors. We'll start with the US dollar. Again, guys, as I said, please keep writing your questions. I'm getting a lot of questions right now. I'll be answering them once I'm finishing my presentation, but I'll try to answer it in the middle as well. Now, US dollar, so we'll see the performance of dollar index. Now, dollar index has ended the year with the smallest ever annual move. It is so for the entire 1 year, the dollar index. Now, what is a dollar index? Dollar index shows the performance of dollar against six major currencies, talking the likes of euro, pound, Swedish krone, currencies like that. So normally what you do, you trade in a currency pair, euro dollar, GBP USD or USD JPY. But when we are looking at a dollar index, the index gives you a much more diversified exposure of a performance. So if I want to say dollar index has gone up or dollar index has come down, what does it mean? It means that the value of dollar was measured against its major currencies like euro, pound, Canadian dollar, Swedish krona, and others, 5-6 major currencies, and then it was found that dollar has gone up or down, right? So the dollar index, it ended the year with the smallest ever annual move, up just 0.2%. So only 0.2% movement throughout the year. Meanwhile, gold was up by 18.8%. Now, this is something which is very significant because a lot of people, they always, and you know, we have always discussed a lot about how gold and US dollar are inversely correlated. and they are inversely correlated. So about two-thirds of the time, when one rises, the other tends to fall, as you can see. So when dollar gets stronger, we see gold prices coming down. When dollar gets weaker, we see gold prices going up. But now if you see the gold prices, it has just gone up by, dollar index just has gone up by 0.24%. We have seen gold going up by 18%. Now, while global investors do tend to move into the US dollar during periods of uncertainty, that move was muted last year, despite, for example, trade war with China. Now, there are two things. When investors get panic, we talk about safe haven. What is a safe haven? Anybody who can tell me the meaning of safe haven can use your chat window. Not necessarily the very definition, one or two words, what you understand from the what you understand from this term safe haven. This is used a lot in the market news. We always talk about safe havens in financial market. What do you understand by safe haven? Anyone? Okay. Okay, I'm getting a couple of answers. Please keep typing. What do you understand by the word safe haven itself? Since I cannot see you, you might as well Google and send me the text. Okay, secure, somebody is saying secure. Okay, treasury bills, safe to invest into with less movement. Okay. Okay, safe asset classes. Okay, yeah, so I think pretty much you're getting the message. Safe haven means something what investors would rely on. Something, exactly, somebody has said moving funds into some less riskier asset class. So let's not call it secured assets, because if we say something is secure, secure means it is risk-free, and there is no such thing in life which is risk-free. So let's not use the word secured asset. Let's use the word less riskier. Okay, the asset classes which are less riskier or low risk of loss, exactly, those are called safe havens. And now gold, from a lot of times we have seen gold has acted like a safe haven. Now when I say safe haven, that means whenever there is an uncertainty, which we are looking at right now, the pandemic, trade war, Brexit referendums, or stock market crashes, a lot of things. We have seen gold prices, they have started moving higher, while we have saw stock prices coming down. This is something which happens. We have seen historically, again, as I said, not necessary that this will always happen, but then that is what the concept of safe haven is. Now we have, so what we are trying to understand is, since last year we have seen that lot of investors have actually preferred gold over dollar, because dollar also at times takes the status of a safe haven. Most of the people, they start investing into dollars as it becomes, if there is a lot of panic, like we saw during the trade war, dollar kept getting stronger with China. Dollar kept getting stronger across the currency pairs. But after, when the trade war has happened, people have very less trust on USD as a currency itself, because it has become more volatile. What is happening with China? Sometimes what happens, China, their currency gets devaluated, dollar gets stronger. Or if there is too much retaliation from China, if there are a lot of tariffs, US tries to promote its exports, we see dollar coming down. So because of the trade war and lot of volatility, lot of investors have switched from US dollar towards gold. So that is one reason that why gold has become a much more favorite safe haven asset as compared to the dollar. So this is the first factor. Right now, what is affecting the prices is US dollar. We have seen dollar not really performing on a very higher note, but gold prices was already, in the last 1 year, we saw it going up by 18%. First half 2020, we have saw it going up by 16.5%, and it continues to go higher back to 2011 levels. So that is your factor number one. Second factor, we talk about the physical demand, which many investors have not really focused upon. A lot of investors, they now see gold, of course, as a safe haven. But whenever we try to forecast the gold prices, a lot of people always will switch on historical price, like central bank interest rates. Interest rates are low, so gold price is supposed to go up. That is just one factor. But what about the other factors when we are looking at? We are looking at physical demand also. This is something which is really important. And if you see demand for the physical metal, we have seen it has been a bit soft in US for a couple of years now. But if you see the overall investment demand, you can see the chart over here. The overall investment demand for gold since 2016 mid until now, the demand for gold has also continued to grow higher. And that is precisely for one of the reason, if you see holdings in the funds, like the exchange traded funds or the ETFs, which are backed by gold, it has been going up. And if we see at the end of 2019, this has gone up even significantly. So the interest in gold from investors' point of view, it is likely to remain higher this year also, because the reasons they bought gold was to hedge against the overvalued markets and ensure against the possibility of a recession or crisis. Now, that is something which has not been materialized yet. I mean, we saw the pandemic. During the pandemic, we saw that gold went up, stock prices came down. And this is still the beginning. Everybody is still talking about a possibility of a recession. There is a still lot of uncertainty about the gold prices. So the physical demand of gold, firstly, by the ETFs, the exchange-traded funds, the funds which are backed by the physical gold assets, if demand for them has continued. See, there are two ways you can take exposure in gold. One is by investing directly into the metal, buying gold as a metal. Or what you can do is you can invest into a fund which is focused on the physical demand, which is focusing on the companies which are buying physical gold. So through ETFs, you can also invest, like how, if you remember, any one of you who attended the previous sessions when we were talking about USO, the United States Oil Fund. So USO had a lot of exposure in direct oil as a commodity. The fund itself was buying a lot of oil futures physical. So rather than taking a exposure directly in the commodity by yourself, you would invest into a fund which is taking a direct exposure in commodity. So similarly, there are a lot of exchange traded funds which are taking, which have been taking exposure in gold as a metal. And there are a lot of investors who have been buying these ETFs. So the demand for those ETFs have continued to go higher. And that's why the investment demand for physical gold also have been increasing. And then overall, obviously, there are a lot of investors who always use gold as a hedge against if stock market goes down, then gold prices are expected to go up. So that is also something which continues. Now, this is one factor which is investment demand. And as I said, it is expected that the continued ETF demand, the demand for investment into funds which are directly taking exposure in gold, it is likely to push the prices of gold on the higher side. So this is also one of the reasons when we are looking at the gold prices, we should also focus on the investment demand. Comes next, the central bank buying. Now, the World Gold Council, it reports that while the pace of buying gold may slow, it fully expects buying to continue. Now, if you're looking at right now, you're looking at the gold trading volumes also, something which we will also discuss further going on, that how the trading volumes of gold has gone up. But just to tell you, the world gold reserves since 1965, we have seen a lot of movement. Like central bank around the world, they hold gold as a reserve asset. If whenever they need more, they will buy more. Now, since 2007, I will share the chart later on with all of you, which I have to include this. Now, the global central banks, they have been buying gold at an accelerated pace over the last 10 years. Even last year, the holdings, like in 2019, it has jumped almost 10%. Like very much, if it jumps by 10% more, it will reach to an all-time high. So the World Gold Council reports that the pace of buying, it might have slowed down, but then they are expecting this buying to continue. And then there is this continued accumulation, which is a major support for the gold prices because they keep buying it. The central banks, if you will see around the world, they will always hold gold as a reserve asset. And especially since 2015, so 2016, 17, 18, and 19, we have seen that gold buying by the central bank, the gold reserves by the central bank has continued to go higher. And in fact, it is just 10% lower till it reaches to the all-time high, which was around 38,000 tons. And that was back in 1965. So the ongoing central bank buying, it is expected that the gold prices might continue to go higher. Now, talking about the trading volumes. So while we are talking about the gold trading volumes also, we are talking about these volumes in COMEX, which is Commodities and Metal Exchange. So the trading volumes right now, what you see, if you see in 2019, 18, 17, this graph shows you that the volumes have continued to be on the higher side. Again, that is something which is a thing. If there are a lot of people trading into gold, there are a lot of buyers and sellers that obviously one create a volatility in the market and it increases a lot of buyers and sellers. So when we see the COMEX trading volumes, this is like the COMEX is like the world's largest futures market. And there are more and more traders who are buying more gold contracts than ever. And when you buy more than you sell, obviously the price is driven higher. So again, we will see it is very easy to find the annual volume. This is not something which is a very specific data. There are a lot of market consultants who are working on similar ideas to identify the volumes. And this is something which you can easily get any kind of information you need about the trading volumes in COMEX. You can always talk to your RMs, talk to your market consultants, and they will be easy to provide you a detailed analysis on it. Now, since we saw the volumes are going up, now there were different factors. We talked about the US dollar, the impact of dollar. We talked about the central bank buying. We talked about the investment demand in the ETFs, which has started increasing. All these factors collectively pushing gold prices higher. Next, the last thing which we are looking at is new mining supply. So demand we talked about, did not talk about the supply yet. Supply is also something which we have to put stress on. We have to understand, like there are a lot of gold analysts as well. They recognize that new supply from the gold producers. And we had a lot of conversations with a lot of gold analysts, and most of them, they agree that the new supply from the gold producers, it is expected to decline. Now, this is a concerning thing about the coming gold supply deficit. What it is, it doesn't require an outside force to make it happen. So, for example, if we talk about the gold producers, they cannot, very quickly increase the output whenever it is needed. So even let's say gold prices went up and now it is very expensive. But if producers have to start mining gold faster, it's not. It's a process. It is not something which is in the hands of outside force, or it is in the hands of the producers to do it. So this is something which comes locked in, and no matter how high the prices can go, but the producers, they cannot very quickly increase the output. Now, why this is one of the biggest problem when it comes to supply, there are a lot of the mining consultants who have reported, and this is the statistics which we have seen. Now, in 2012, the gold industry spent around $11 billion on exploration. In 2019, $4.4 billion was spent. Now, if you see, back in 2012, gold prices were also higher, and there was a lot of money which was spent on the exploration. And while we are talking in 2019-2020, we are looking at barely even half of it is now spent on the mining of gold. So this is something, if you're spending obviously less looking for something, you're finding it less. You're looking at, if you look at the year 2000 also, there were around 42 major gold discoveries, 1 million ounce deposits or bigger than that, which in 2019, last year, there were only 3 gold discoveries. If you see in 1985, average grade of gold which was mined around the world was around 5.17 grams per ton of ore. In 2017, it was just 1.5. So this is something which is, again, these are some statistics which is which you need to look at when you are forecasting the gold prices. Again, guys, those analysts who are talking about low interest rates and putting it as one of the major reasons that why gold prices are, of course, interest rates are something which everybody talks about, lower the interest rate, dollar supply is in excess, there is injection of stimulus, a lot of stimulus. So gold prices, they go higher. That is, again, likely to go higher. So that is one aspect. The idea for today to understand the outlook for gold is to analyze all other factors, especially the decreasing supply and the increasing investment demand. That is something which is really important. Because now the question of the hour is, where do we see gold prices going? It is already up to a level of 2011 and 12. So in last 8 to 9 years, gold has reached to that range which it was 8 years, 9 years ago. So this is something which is really important from here, whether it will go back or it is expected to go up. So these new factors which I'm talking about, it really gives some light to what is expected of the gold prices. We are looking at increased demand in last few years. We are looking at a reduced supply. We are seeing that a lot of, normally back in 2012, a lot of money was spent in the exploration. Now half of it is normally spent for the exploration. Less gold discoveries. If you see, the average cost to discover a new gold deposit 30 years ago was $53 million. Now it is $149. So almost twice the rise in inflation. Then estimated $30 billion in value was created from gold exploration between 2009 and 2018. But the industry spent $67.5 billion to find that value. So a lot of things due to inflation, the average cost also has been increasing. So there are a lot of other factors as well. Now coming back to the point, we have not seen the technical factor yet. We have not included technical analysis on this. Supports, resistance, that is again something, study of the historic price movements. But the idea is, what to sum up what we have understood in these factors is, one is the US dollar, which was the first thing. We saw that the dollar index has not moved that much. We also understood that gold prices have gone up by 18%. People, the investor sentiment has actually switched from dollar as a safe haven to gold as a safe haven, which again is a big, big factor when we look at. We also talked about next factor, which was the investment demand. We talked about that how the demand for physical metal, it has been soft in US from a couple of years, but now the overall demand, if we see, it has surged because a lot of exchange traded funds, a lot of ETFs, they have been investing into gold, the physical asset, and we have seen the surge in the metal. A lot of investors are also buying gold for the very reason to use it hedge as a hedge for their portfolios. We talked about central bank and how the reserves have actually increased. They always keep buying gold as a reserve asset, and we have seen that over last 10 years, we have seen that how gold buying has actually accelerated. And even last year, it was even higher. And this is a very, very strong uptrend. The buying pace may slow, but then it will still expect it to continue. So the ongoing buying is again a bullish or upside for the gold prices, expected upside for the gold prices. Then we talked about the trading volumes, how the trading volumes have also continued to go higher for some time. So unless there is any indication of slowing down the volumes, it is expected that the prices might continue to go higher. Then we saw about the mining supply. We saw that how that overall cost of mining gold has increased. We also saw, discovering new gold deposits, the average cost to it has increased. We also saw that how the industry has spent more money previously back in 2012, but in last year, the money was not as much spent on exploring gold as well. So these are few hindrances which might affect the supply, because it does not depend on the producers to mine the gold quickly or not. So if price continues to go up, it is not like to meet the high prices, the supply can, you know, quickly level the demand. That will still happen at their own pace. So if demand rises and supply is falling, gold prices might respond to the basic supply demand equation, which is one thing. Last but not the least, we reached to the point where we talk about the economic and monetary factors. Now, economic and monetary factors, where it comes the point we talk about the interest rates. Because of the pandemic, the global central banks, they have kept their interest rates lower. They have kept their interest rates down and a lot of money has been injected. Lower interest rates, which means borrowings are cheaper. A lot of people can borrow credit at a cheaper price. They can continue with their businesses, expand, develop. So overall, the supply of dollars increase. And when supply of dollars increase with the respective demand of dollars, when there is excess of supply, the value of dollar comes down. Dollar and gold with the inverse valuation, if dollar comes down, gold goes up. So that is something which is, again, one of the important factors. Not the only factor, but one of the important factors. All of the above I have discussed, these are the reasons. And again, economic factors also can be one of the reasons. When I'm talking about the economic factors, talking about what is happening with the economy. GDP price, the GDPs have almost, the forecast of the GDP is still down. We were talking about, how pandemic has affected the manufacturing, how pandemic has affected the markets. There was an entire lockdown and we saw a decline in the manufacturing. So economies have been really impacted because of the pandemic. There have been stock markets have taken a hit. We will just visit the platform now and see that at what point the stock market started coming down and gold prices also started going up. So that fear of recession always persuades an investor to invest into gold and use it as a hedge in case if the economy slows down and stocks started coming down. Now, if a stock market reverses from the potential upside, if you see right now, the equities are going higher and higher, stocks are going up today. But if there is a reversal or a possible recession, then gold prices may likely push higher. What can push gold prices down is, let's say stock market continue to go up, inflation, if it doesn't go too high, because normally what happens is if inflation becomes too much higher, which is an alarming situation, so we might see gold prices also moving higher. But at this point of time, if the stock prices go up and there is no such increase in inflation, if those things happen and all other situation is normal, then gold prices might go down. So that is again one thing. But as we are all looking at currently, ahead of the pandemic situation, cases in Florida, cases in US are increasing. Singapore of lately has said that they are dipping into recession. Lot of economies are coming up with different statements when it comes to pandemic. In India itself, if you see, lot of cases are on the rise. So the current rally of equities, whether it will last or not, but every investor would seek to find a safe haven, and a part of the investments should be diversified in order to at least prepare yourself against a fall if it comes in. So it is not wrong to prepare yourself and have the best of the risk management. So this is something which you can. Now, how one can invest into gold? So we talked about a lot that what factors can actually push gold prices higher. We can also understand how to invest into gold. Now, investing into gold can be through, as I said, investing into directly as a physical commodity. Physical commodity, you buy gold, a TT bar, keep it at your home, which is not really safe if you're buying a large quantity. When there are online platforms where you can buy gold, obviously online platforms, a lot of platforms provide leverage facilities, and leverage is something which is like a double-edged sword. If not used properly, your losses might exceed deposits. So leverage is something which you need to be very, very careful in understanding. So if you're using an online platform, I'll show you the platform which I'm using here, which we are providing it over here, which is called Trade Room. And over here, you can buy gold, you can sell it, you can buy and hold it. So the first idea is, if you're not buying it physical, you can buy it virtually. Now, how you can buy it virtually? First, what we are looking at the gold historic price movement, right? Before I end this session, I would revisit how gold was. Normally, they talk about BC. BC is before crisis of 2008. And then AC, which is after crisis of 2008. So we will talk about how gold performed before the crisis and how went up the crisis. We'll also talk about the smaller price movements and now what is the situation. So before that, let's try to understand that how we can trade in gold. Please keep asking any questions if somebody has. Please keep writing it over the chat. Okay, somebody said, gold prices soar and investors started piling in. However, every single time that this happened, the price has ultimately collapsed. Over the long term, gold has barely kept up with inflation. That said, gold is considered highly speculative as opposed to being an investment. So how it can be investment, especially in peak price? Very good question. Very good question and very good observation. So guys, see, when I started talking about gold as an investment, I have used a lot of times the word hedge. I have used a lot of times the word safe haven. So the idea is somebody who is already invested into stocks, is invested into equities. Historically, it has been seen that the investors who are heavily invested into stocks, they seek gold as a safe haven and as a safety measure that in case if the stock started falling down, gold prices might go up. So gold is used mostly as a hedging instrument. It is used mostly as a safe haven. Yes, speculation day on day, it completely depends upon your risk tolerance. So the second half where somebody has asked this question, gold is considered is highly speculative and as opposed to being an investment. So how it can be investment, especially in the peak price. So the idea was, the first idea was to understand that what is the outlook for gold. The factors which I have brought in today indicate a bullish stand for gold, which means likely there is a possibility that with increasing physical demand and reducing supply, what is going on with the pandemic, with lower interest rates, dollar not being a choice of safe haven, there's a possibility that over the period of time, prices may likely to be higher. We say this we call $1,800 a peak price because this is the peak which we saw in 2011, almost closer to an all-time high. Last high was around 1920 or 1930, that was back in 2011. So with, let me also, while we are talking, let me publish this poll also. I have put up a poll. Now, I'm sure many of you have a completely different outlook about gold, and I think this is a wonderful thing. We need to have the yeses and nos. So if any of you think gold will touch $2,000, vote for a yes. Any one of you think it will not. There are no right and wrong answers. It is a perception. Obviously, what I am saying will also constitute to different factors. The factors which we have studied now depends on the market conditions. What happens to the price? Again, it will be a market condition. So the answer to the question is very simple. Gold should be used as an instrument to diversify. I'm not saying that you take all your savings out from your banks and start investing in gold because it is going to go higher. That is not exactly not what I'm saying. All I'm saying is that a lot of investors, they would invest into gold as a safe haven. And if you already have a portfolio in stocks, and if you already have invested into equities, given how the situation is, a likely diversified instrument can be gold. It is, again, gold is a speculative, gold is a commodity, gold has a history of falling, gold also has a history of rising during the economic crisis. So we'll go through this, what happens when economic crisis happened and what happened when the interest rates were low, more money was introduced, what happened to the prices. Then you decide whether you want to get into it or not. So the fair answer to the question is very simple, not asking you to invest in gold, exhausting all your savings. It should be used mostly as a hedging instrument, and the factors supporting it, I have already listed it down. So, and because a proper historical price movement has also been pointed out, so I will also go to a historic chart and we'll discuss these factors, that what has been the reason why gold prices have gone up and down, so we can discuss. Let's 10 more seconds before everybody votes for the poll, and then I will publish the results as well. You have 10 more seconds, which suggest everyone if you can do that. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, so I'm going to end this poll now. Okay, please tell me if you can see the results. Anybody who can, are the results displayed on the screen? Although I've put the setting as display the results as soon as the poll ends. How many of you can see the poll results? Can anybody see the poll results? Just give me a yes or no. Okay, so as you can see from the result, now, again, as I said, no right and wrongs, it's your perception. There are a few factors which we have discussed about, and that's why I just wanted to, before I put the poll, I just wanted to make sure that we can discuss all the factors. You can buy, a lot of people are saying 70% say yes, 30% are saying no, and obviously it's an individual perception. Either way, the point of doing this presentation is to show you that what are the factors which can impact the gold prices in the future, and then can what is the expected outlook. Somebody asked me what is the best strategy for short-term trading in gold. So yeah, let's revisit the platform. Now we can see gold prices here. First, we'll talk about a short-term trading strategy. So short-term trading strategies in gold, let's see gold right now as it was described by one of the attendees, speculative asset class, which is correct. It is one of the most speculative asset classes because commodities are speculative. You talk about crude oil, for example. I mean, crude oil prices actually gone negative in the month of April. So without a doubt, commodities can be very speculative. And that's why I said that you don't have to borrow or take a loan or leave your job to invest in commodities or speculate in commodities. Now, to trade into short term, we have to understand, am I trading for today? Do I want to take a trade today and leave it for 1 month or 2 months or 3 months? Or I'm looking at a very short term trading opportunity. I buy today and I sell it today and I go home again tomorrow, a new day I can do. So starting with a short-term trading, just understand this thing and try this, not in your live accounts. Call your relationship managers and use demo accounts for this. Demo account is one of the best ways to test. Profit or loss, don't care about that in the demo accounts because there is no guarantee. If you're making a profit in a demo account, doesn't mean you're going to make a profit in the live account. Demo account is to make you familiar with what you're trading. And you can always check in the prices of these commodities. It is a simple, if things go out of sight, then it is out of your mind. So with demo accounts, things can be in front of you. You can always check the prices when you want. And this is something which is, you can do it on a daily basis. Now for short-term trading, first and foremost, we have to understand the average true range of gold. How much gold moves over a period of day? Okay. Now, if I see, let's say I will change this chart into, okay, instead of 11 years, I'll talk about today. Now, today, if you see the lowest what gold has seen, 1802 today, and I'm looking here right now, if everybody can see this, lowest what gold has seen is 1802. Highest what gold has seen is here, 1814. Please let me just increase the font size so everybody can see this properly. Okay, I'm putting very large fonts here. Okay. Please, anybody who's getting any questions in their mind, keep writing. I will be answering these questions as well. Now, when we are talking about, now you can see the prices on the right side, I'm zoomed in. The lowest we saw was 1802. Highest we saw 1814. This is today, which means gold has given a $12 movement over a day, right? Let's take this further. Instead, let's take it for one day. Go further down, 3 days of movement. So if I say, over a period of 3 days, lowest gold has shown is 1790. Highest, average highest range is 1811. So we're talking about $20-$25 movement in last 2-3 days. Consider this, and it is normally seen. Note it down somewhere if you have a pen and paper. On an average day, with things being normal, there is no normal. So let's tell this not a very normal situation, but on a regular day, gold prices are normally moving around $15 to $20. Let's call it a very regular day. $15 to $20 is something which is very common, very common. Maybe back in 2010 or 11, it was not that much, but now 11 to $12 is what we are watching right now. But on the day of action, $25, $30, it easily happens. So on a normal day, consider the price of gold around $15 to $20. If this is the average movement, so if you're looking at a short-term trade, first thing what you have to do is understand the duration of the chart. So this is here, you're looking at, let's say, hourly charts. What are hourly charts? We will have a technical analysis session soon, so do join it, so you will be able to understand how candlesticks work and everything. But right now, just understand it this way. Every candle over here, every bar over here represents an hour. So if you see here, this is 7 to 8. Right now, this bar which has formed, it started at 7 o'clock, and in the next 4 minutes, this will end, and another bar will start forming here. Similarly, the previous bar was from 6 to 7 o'clock. When I started the webinar at 7, it was around 1807. Over the period of 1 hour when we have been talking, it reached to a high. Now when I click on the cursor on your left side, if you can see, there's a H which says high 1811, there is L which says low 1806, and when the hour ended, it was at 1811. Now sorry, over here, a highest 1812, low 1803. So 6 to 7, between 6 to 7, gold went to a lowest of 1803 and climbed a highest of 1812. That means around $8 to $9. From 7 to 8, gold high was 1811, low was 1806. So between around $4 to $5. Now, hour on hour basis, if gold is moving around 5 to 8 or $8 to $10, what you can do is take a trade for that particular, looking at hourly charts, you can take trades on the basis of support and resistances. So as a short-term trading, if I zoom out, just look at this. On a short-term trading basis, I see a decent support level to enter into the gold prices . I just drew a line, see if it is clearer to you. A decent gold entry to buy could be one which I can see without any effort could be this, because if you see this level and if you ask why this on a short-term basis, gold price reached here, or if it reaches here, goes up, reaches here, bounced back, again, reached here, bounced back, bounced back, bounced back, tried to break it, could not break, bounced back, bounced back, bounced back. Again, there was a false breakout, could not sustain. Look at this thread, bounced back, bounced back. So now again, if gold prices come to 1796 or 1795, a preferable trade, which where most likely there is a possibility that prices might go higher, could be 1796. Again, you asked me about the short-term trading, I would tell you a short-term trading. On the other side, if you see a short-term trading here, now tell me, let me remove the current price window. And now if you see a very prominent level, I think here, right? Which means most of the time gold price is touching 1814, it comes down. So I can understand a range between 1814 to between 1796, where, and this is last 9 days from 8th of July to 16th of July. So we are looking at why I've taken this period. I've taken hourly period, which is more important for short term. And what I have done is I just zoomed out and tried to find a range, tried to find a channel. Now, thankfully, with the market consultants, it is easier to identify support and resistances, because they're already looking at the charts. And as you can see over here, this is not something which is a rocket science. This is something which is visible in front of you. So looking at the historic, when you're talking about short-term trades or short-term trading, the one of the strategies for gold is when you're speculating, you look at the support and resistances, okay? And look at the shorter time frames. If you're looking at day-on-day closings, then you're not talking about short-term trading. You're talking about long-term trades. 2 days, 3 days, 5 days. If you go further weeks, then go for weeks, months, and years. So if you're talking about short-term trades, 1 hour window, 30 minutes window, 5 minutes window. This is something which you can see it on day-on-day basis and try to identify the range. One important thing which a lot of investors, they do a mistake when they are trading or they're speculating. They enter into at any prices and they put a stop loss. You can put a stop loss. You can restrict your losses, which is a good thing. But do not enter at any price. If it is in the middle of this, wait for a prominent support line or a resistance line to come before you buy or sell. Now, also, you can also take help of a few technicals, which again, with practice, you will easily be able to identify this. Something as easy as RSI to begin with. Now, if you see, these are the shaded areas. Normally, the rule of RSI is very simple. There are two lines, 70% threshold and 30% threshold. As you can see, most of the time it reaches. So the idea is when it reaches below 30%, normally this area, it comes under oversold category and it indicates a buying signal when RSI comes below 30%. When it goes above 70%, becomes an overbought category and likely the prices could be expected to come down. So you don't have to trade every day. You don't have to trade all the time. You have to trade when you see a support resistance, or which could be here on a RSI, or which could be here on a support line or a resistance line. And obviously, with the help of the market consultants or training, I always encourage people to use demo accounts. Come to the offices, sit for trainings and understand how this is done. And there is no way that you should pay money for this and learn this in an institute, because as we have seen, when we talk about something speculative, whose prices can be affected by geopolitics, whose prices can be affected by a lot of other factors, when we talk about something this speculative, we have to understand that there is no institute which can teach you, which can charge you and teach you, because there will never be a guarantee that these prices will go up or down. So you have to make sure. So that's why when you buy stocks, there is never a guarantee that the stocks are going to go up. So you have to ensure that there is a diversified asset class where you could, where you have invested or hedged against the equities also. So that is one way. So short-term trading can be done on the basis of an hourly chart with proper support and resistances. Second thing, guys, one more strategy. Now, that is not a short-term trading strategy, but it is a very different strategy from the whole speculation bit. That strategy is called arbitrage. Now, arbitrage is it's a very unique, I wouldn't say unique, but it's a rare opportunity which one can get. And arbitrage is based on the basis of price anomalies. And there are opportunities which come when two asset classes of similar nature, whose prices have always gone in sync, but when they deviate from each other due to market anomalies, then you short sell one and you buy another. And when the gap becomes again closed, that is where you have booked your net profit. And there is an arbitrage opportunity which has currently passed in the gold prices. Right now, if we see the movement, because future contract is very close to the expiry, so we have now we don't have that current opportunity, but in the past month we have seen. So how the arbitrage opportunity comes in, right now you are looking at gold cash, which is also called gold spot. There is something called, which you can easily identify from here, as gold future. Okay, now gold future, this is the August contract which you see right now. Okay, let me show you the two prices here. Now if you see, gold cash is priced 1812, gold future contract is priced 1815. Look at this gap. This gap right now, what you see is around $3, okay, between the spot and the future. Now, there is something which I could show you. Just try to understand this. And again, guys, please understand this. The strategies which we talk about, the possibilities which we talk about, everything is subjected to the market conditions and market risk. Please do not take this as a recommendation or an advice. You have to understand your risk tolerance. What I am telling you is on the basis of the historical price movement. And this is something which we have seen in the past. But again, historical price movement is not a guarantee for the future. So this is, again, it always investment is an experiment. So please, those who have joined right now, don't worry. We are about to finish this session. So we'll upload a recorded session for this. So nothing to worry about. Now, what I'm about to show you, one second. Okay. Right here. Okay. Now, what you can see over here, this is a PDF, okay? And this shows you from the very first column. Let me zoom this a bit. Must be easier to see. Okay. So, I have prepared this for investors who have a conservative risk tolerance, which means low, then moderate to aggressive. We are not going to talk about moderate and aggressive. Let's keep everything conservative at a slightly lower risk. So now the table which you're looking at, you just saw gold prices. The spot is 1812 and the future gold August contract is 1815. So $3 difference. This difference in the past was, so this PDF was prepared one or two months ago, and where we were seeing that the difference when gold price was 1757, August future contract, which is supposed to expire in the next 15 days now, price was 1774. So the difference between both the prices was $17. The same difference what you see right now is $3. This difference was around $17. Okay, that means what has happened is when the future contract comes near the expiry, there is a convergence of the spot and the future prices, what we have seen historically. Okay, so the idea of the arbitrage is simple, that when this gap is $17, now through standard deviation and through constant monitoring of the data, you can find out an average gap, like which is right now it says gap of 17. But how do you know what is an average gap? What is the mean gap? So through standard deviation, you can find that the mean gap is around $15. So that's why when it goes to 17, or when it goes to the highest it has gone is 24. So mostly when it comes to 15, it starts going back. So now when it went 17, so the idea was very simple. The asset which is on the out, which has outperformed, which is your future contract, you short sell it. The one which has underperformed, you buy it, expect this gap to reduce. Okay. To know more about short selling, you can see our videos on YouTube that what short selling is. You can also book a personal training session. Talk to your relationship managers. It is absolutely free of cost, and we can have a face-to-face conversation that what short selling is and how to exploit the arbitrage opportunity. Because this gap what you see, which is $17, this similar gap what we see right now, if I go back to the platform now, here, this gap is around $3 right now. This is important because earlier this gap was 17, now this gap is 3. So that opportunity has been exploited automatically. Now, when this contract expires, and we'll see the next contract, and then we'll see whether there's an arbitrage possible, depends on what is the gap. Because the next contract which we see, which will be your gold December contract. Look at the price for the December contract. Now the price of the December contract is around 1842. But only way to find out that whether there's an arbitrage opportunity or not is when the gold contract expires in the next 15 days and the December contract becomes the new contract. That's where we see that what is the difference between gold cash and the current future contract. So if the gap is around again $17 to $18 or more than that, again there could be an arbitrage opportunity where you short sell the future and buy the spot and wait for this gap to reduce, like how it has reduced between this, that $17 gap has reduced to $3. So this is something which is called arbitrage, which a lot of investors are doing it. Please understand this. If you have to do it right, please come and understand how to do this. Don't jump onto the conclusion. There is always a timing to do this. And by the way, what I should highlight over here also, would like to take you on the notes section which were prepared. Here. Yeah, quickly to scroll down, please understand this. Again, there is a dedicated capital which is assumed to be taken when we are doing the arbitrage examples. The spread trade between gold cash and gold futures, right? This is a spread trade. We call it a statistical arbitrage, but normally we are talking about the spread. Spread is the price difference between the spot and the future, the difference between the prices between spot and the future. There is a holding cost which is subjected to change. There's a holding cost which is charged on the spot gold, okay, not on the futures, and that holding cost can change month on month. Okay, so there is that one risk. Also, not necessary that always the spread might converge. Although we have seen it in the historical past that most of the time it does, but again, as I said, it is not always necessary that the prices will converge. His spread historically, as you can see, it has ranged between $0.10 to $25. All-time high, $41. So because when this pandemic came, gold prices started going higher a lot. So there was a lot of gap between the spot and the future and went really high. So you have to understand, you have to understand your risk. The spread trade also comes with a lot of conditions, a lot of expectations of the risk. So you have to So you have to please understand that these are the risks involved. Do not always think that this is something which is which can be risk-free. There is no thing which is risk-free. You should know how to do it right. You should put a substantial amount of capital, but at the same time, do not take a very higher risk. Accounts should be well-funded with margins, and monitoring of the spread should be also done by you. The consultants are looking at it, but you also have to get involved into it. So this is one way. Another, last but not the least, one more way to invest into gold, not for short term, but for a longer term, can be through ETFs, which we are talking about, exchange traded funds. There are a lot of ETFs which you can find on this platform. So when you write gold ETFs, you will find there are a lot of companies. There is SPDR, there is ProShares, WisdomTree. In fact, I think this is a ticker for, like, for example, Vanek Vector's Gold Miners ETF. If you see the performance of this, it has continued to go up since June. And the most important thing, pandemic. Look at this price movement. From pandemic, March, from $17, it has gone up to $38, right? March, April, May, June. In last 3 months, from $17, it has gone to $38. So the point is, it has almost moved up 100% over a period of last 3 months. And this is a company, this is a exchange-traded fund, a fund which it focuses on the companies which are mining gold. So that's why it is called a gold miners ETF. So you can invest into the commodity of gold by looking at support and resistances, direct exposure. You can do arbitrage. Again, the risk for the spread trade or the statistical arbitrage are already given. To understand more, please come to the office, contact your relationship managers, understand how to do this right. Needless to say, the risks are always involved. Last but not the least, you can use ETFs to invest. As you can see, the performance of the ETFs have also, it has shown a very considerable growth from March till June, because gold prices moved up, so moved the prices of these kind of ETFs also, right? So this is again something, guys, it's a very basic thing. It's not a rocket science. You just have to explore your options. Long-term investment, you can invest into different gold mining companies individually, or you can just invest into a fund which is showing you a growth, okay? And gold as a metal, if you're speculating, use support and resistances, or it can also be used as a hedging instrument if you have a big exposure in stocks and equities. Many investors can find safe haven in gold. So there are different ways you can invest or speculate into gold, given the risk which are concerned. So now, before we leave, let's revisit. I promised you that I will show you what has happened to the gold prices in the past. For that, we'll go back to what happened in 2011. I will clear this and go back and see. Yeah. We all know the not so famous 2008, the infamous 2008 asset bubble, the housing crashes. This is the last segment, guys. So just bear with me for six minutes more. We saw gold prices. Now we saw, this is the gold chart. So we saw equities coming down during 2008. Okay. Now, if you see, for those people who have always, so there are a lot of analysts who said, I also told you right now that when stocks came down, most likely the gold prices, they go up. But if you see there, it did not happen. When stocks came down in 2008, over a period of 2008 here, we saw till December that the prices of gold also were falling. Look here. This price, let me draw a small line here. Look this. So gold price continued to go down through 2008. But then what happened? in 2009 and 11 that the gold prices from here, sorry, not this. That gold prices just went up. What happened between after 2008, between 9, 2000 to 2012 for the next 3 years? While we saw gold prices going from $876 to 1900, the highest was 1905 to 1905. What was the reason? From $800 to 1900 in the span of 3 years. The very reason was when the stock markets came down, gold prices also came down. But why gold prices went up? Because to deal with this major crisis, central bank under the leadership of Ben Bernanke, they started injecting more dollars, printing more dollars as a currency, calling it quantitative easing. It is also known as a stimulus. It is also known as bond buying programs or market operational programs. So the Fed, US Federal Reserve, they started printing more currency, which would next for the next 2-3 years, they would continue and more dollars will be supplied, injected in the economy through bond purchase, through reprinting of currency to increase the flow of cash in the economy. Interest rates will be slashed down, which depreciates dollar and push gold prices higher. This was the time when gold prices going up. Now, what happened in 2013? What happened in 2015? Now, the area which you see this particular chart, now let's talk about, let's draw a channel. What happened around this scenario before 2019 breakout happened till here? And sorry, where is the channel? So this price from here till here. When you see this range, this is from 2013, 2014 to 2019 before the breakout happened. So I'm just going to make a line for this also. As I can see here, small something which we saw. Again, it broke the entire. What was this channel and what was happening? So during 2014, I think 2013-14 onwards, when stimulus happened, over a period of, I think in 2014 itself, there were news of central bank stopping the whole stimulus program. That means there were a lot of investors the central bank simply said that now the economy is recovering. This was the time when stock markets again started going higher. And we saw that people also started investing into more equities rather than the safe havens. And plus, central bank started talking about how to cut down the stimulus program, how to stop reprinting currencies by step on step, which is called tapering of the QE program, tapering of the quantitative easing program. Now, when they started talking, imagine this, it has not even happened yet, but there is a Federal Reserve press conference and the central bank gave a hint that we are going to now stop doing quantitative easing, which made dollar stronger, which pushed also the gold prices to a level when it came here, as you can see, 1300. Now, this is around 2013. We saw going it down to 2014. 2014 again, then came 2015 when after 10 years, after 8 or 9 years, when the first time the interest rate hike happened. And if you remember, Janet Yellen did the honors back in 2015, that when the first interest rate hike happened, I think that was 31st December 2015, closer to 2016. So we saw gold prices going down further, right? And then went down to 2066. Then we saw again, I think this was the time when the interest rate hike happened and we saw it going down. Now, also, if you see, there is again a rise in the gold prices in 2016, because January 2016, when interest rates have already gone up. So gold came down. But also in 2016, many of you will remember there was a Chinese slowdown and the manufacturing in slowdown in the Chinese economy, it started. And China started going through a very tough phase. And first half of 2016, very first month, first 14 days of 2016, stock markets would see a major crash. And that's where we saw gold prices rising back from 1,000 to 1,300. And when there was a slight recovery, we saw again gold prices falling down to 1,190, finding the support over here. Then came 2017. Now 2016 also, if you remember, here, why the gold prices have come down. November 2016. Anybody who can tell me what happened in November 2016 that gold prices fell from 1,300 to 1,100? Anyone? What happened in November 2016 which put gold prices down? November 2016. Nobody can forget this day. Take a wild guess. I'll give you one hint. It is related to tweet. No, it is related to Twitter. What happened in 2016 in November which pushed gold prices down? And let me tell you, at the same time, the stocks have started going really high and gold prices have started coming down. Okay, I'll give you 5 more seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So November 2016 is when Donald Trump became the president. That's what the day US presidential elections happened. Trump was elected president. US markets all-time high. Gold prices going down. So as you can see, once again, the stock markets, people have started taking money out of the safe haven, started putting money into equities, right? So now we saw here, again, gold prices came down. Then in 2017, we saw gold prices going up because this will be the time now. Also in June 2016, as you can see, June 2016, this slide over here, we saw a push in the prices from 1200 to 1320. What was it in June 2016? Brexit referendum. So stock went down, gold went up. Then November 2016, Trump became president, stock went up, gold came down. Then we saw by the end of, again, beginning of 2017, we saw gold prices steadily moving around. Over 2018, again, by 2018, gold prices had reached to 1300. And when it started, so during this time, the concept of trade war also started coming in, Brexit issues, so gold was high. And then finally, over a period of June and July, the first phase of when, if you see here, 2019, when the moment it has started, the gold prices started coming down on Trump tweets, stock markets going all-time high, Trump tweeting about making America great again, Trump tweeting about there has been great progress between US and China, although China kept coming and tweeting that there has been no such progress, but a lot of stock, that all-time stocks high and gold prices going down. And then what you see right now is the breakout on the range. This started in 2019 when trade war went a step ahead. Threat of we started looking tensions between North Korea. We started looking tensions in Iran, Saudi, Russia, attacks on Saudi throughout 2019, where we saw now finally over the pandemic, gold prices have started going higher. This is a historical push in gold. So every time we have seen in the historical price movement that whenever the equities have started going up, gold prices have come down. Whenever equities have started come down, gold prices most of the time have moved up. So which makes it a like of safe haven to for the clients to hedge their portfolio against. So this is one way. You can also use put options in equities to hedge it. It's up to you, right? So guys, once again, thank you so much. Somebody asked me a question about cryptocurrency, that which is the most traded cryptocurrency and what is the expectations. See, guys, with cryptocurrencies, first thing which you have to understand is crypto don't have one thing which normally every investor would see. So crypto is one of the most speculative, high risk asset classes. And you have to understand about cryptos that any outlook which comes across, it will be on the basis of only the technicals. If I see a good support price, I would tell you that, okay, you know, you can probably buy, or you can probably sell because it is at a resistance. You can probably buy because it is at a support. But we have to keep in mind one big factor, that the fundamentals of the cryptocurrency are really in question, because the legitimacy is always a big question. And when we talk about blockchain, see, last year for cryptos have been very significant. There was a kind of an uptick I think if you see in litigation around fraud and misuse in 2019, lot of investors, they have lost around $4 billion to a lot of malicious acts which happened. In terms of when we talk about blockchain, obviously there is a lot of interest in the blockchain. If you see companies like Oracle, companies like IBM, they have shown a great interest in blockchain as a technology. We are still looking at momentum that, with looking like, if we are looking at the COVID-19 pandemic, how the cryptocurrencies or the blockchain could be of importance. See, if we look at 2020 as a time of tremendous change, we can always think that the adoption for cryptocurrency will likely to grow, because governments and financial institutions, they always have seen digital money as a way to distribute aid and financial services. You talk about medical supply, you talk about pharmaceuticals, other industries. They may look more closely at how a distributed ledger of technology can fix some of the problems in the supply chain. So again, everything can be of importance. But then when we talk about whether it is connecting the nations or not, whether blockchain is receiving that status or not, how the technology is going to progress, everything lies on very one important thing, that whether cryptos will have that legitimacy of being of getting a wider acceptance. Because if that is not happening, then all what I'm saying is a completely pointless thing. Because if during the pandemic, there are a lot of central banks use digital payments as a way to provide aid. A lot of technology, whether it is pharmaceutical, whether it is agriculture industry, they put blockchain as a very important concept of technology. So all these things should give rise to provide legitimacy to the cryptos. But this has happened in the past, and cryptos have never got that wider acceptance, which makes them a still very speculative asset class. I cannot look at central bank decisions and take a trade on Bitcoin, but I can take a trade on Euro. So personally, I feel that if you are willing to take a similar amount of risk as high as to invest into a crypto, I suggest better to deviate that and invest into currencies and commodities, because there's a wider acceptance. Unlike Bitcoin or a crypto, gold has the intrinsic value. As far as other forex is concerned, euro, pound, if I'm taking a trade, I'm taking a risk, but at least my trade is based on the rationale of looking at the statistics by central banks, interest rates, industrial production, GDP, trade deficit, import, export, a lot of things. Cryptos don't have any of those. Mostly we have seen cryptos going higher on when Bitcoin halving event was there. Or, when we saw over the time when there were talks, when Bitcoin became a standard future contract in CME and CBOE, that was the time. But all those things have faded. So we have not seen any much action in cryptos. Plus, as a volatile instrument, it's really hard to put a buy or a sell perspective on it. So please understand this, cryptos, as far as until there is no legitimacy confirmed on it, although during the pandemic time, it is a need of an hour to make things more digital. We have seen this happening with e-commerce industry. We have seen that happening with remote communication. What we are doing right now is a form of digitalization. So yes, maybe in the future we might see that happening. But then again, if there is no legitimacy of a crypto, then none of this can work out. Then it is still an asset which is as speculative even more speculative than currencies and commodities, right? Somebody asked me about how to get a demo account. Guys, you can get demo accounts very easily. You can just have to call your relationship managers. If you want to meet me person on person, I'll be available here in office. We have all the precautions. Social distancing is maintained. If you want a Zoom call one-on-one, please talk to your RMs and we can arrange a Zoom call as well. Even if you visit the office, all the precautions are here. Mask, gloves, everything. So up to you whether you want to come to the office, have a training session. Free of cost, no commitments. Please come and learn more about this. And any other questions if you have about opening the account. Somebody asked me about how to open an account. Opening account is very simple. It needs passport, copy, visa, and address proof, and the account gets opened in 2 days. But for that, you can contact your relationship managers and they will be able to help you. I would suggest please use demo accounts more and more. Talk to your relationship managers. Try to get more and more research on your email and read more. Be more aware of what is happening around. That being said, thank you so much once again. We'll have another session next week. And after that, we have one more session for the technical bit where we will talk more about charts, candlesticks, and anyone who wants to come to the office, most welcome. So thank you once again. On behalf of my company, my team, myself, thank you once again to those who are in the healthcare industry, risking their lives day in and day out. I know that offices have opened at most places, but do social distancing, wear your mask, stay safe, and also stay invested. That is something which should never get out of your window. Staying invested is one of the most important things, but please stay safe, take all the precautions, and do contact your relationship managers if you have any issues regarding understanding of this platform. This will be the session will be uploaded on YouTube, and if you want to have any more discussion about leverage, how to put a trade, how to short sell, how to manage your risk, let's have a one-on-one session on Zoom. And the technical session, somebody asked me about the technicals. We're planning to have it by the end of the month, but if you cannot wait and you want to connect and meet, just call to your relationship manager and fix a technical session for yourself. It is absolutely free of cost. Just tell a day prior and we'll provide you a time slot one-on-one, and we'll start with a very basic of technicals, that what are candlesticks, how to draw trend lines, the kind of stuff right now what I'm showing it to you, something which is really easy, which is in front of you, not something which is very rocket science, but we'll try to make it much more simpler and neatly packaged for you, right? Thank you, guys. Thank you once again. I hope to see you here in the office. And or over a Zoom call. Stay safe. Stay invested. Thank you once again.